just a lady in the tiniest chair of the chateau.
Hi.
Hi. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good.
Are you? You must be enjoying this. You're actually a Golden Globe nominee.
I'm really enjoying it. It's like I was so surprised and excited, and I didn't even know that the Golden Globe nominations were on the morning that they were on. I mean, I had talked to one, I think, member of the Hollywood Foreign Press once.
Quietly on the side.
Yeah.
You didn't do the whole dog and pony show?
Mm-mm.
See, that's particularly unusual for you to get a nomination without actually kissing a lot of totos.
I was really shocked and surprised and excited.
Well, these days, I guess Coyote Ugly would have gotten you a nomination.
Maybe, I don't know.
You know, with burlesque up there, Cher's in, you would have been in. You're the Cher of your generation.
Thank you.
I think pretty much.
That's the first time anyone's ever told me that.
Soon
I'll take it.
Soon there'll be drag queens.
If I look that good, I will take it.
Tighten it up every week. You gotta in the back of the. Anyway, so you've been doing this now about 15 years?
I've been doing this now, let's see, I started in 98.
So a dozen years.
A dozen years.
Why did you start?
I always wanted to do it. When I went to college and studied theater, and like 2 weeks after I graduated, I moved to New York with like a coffee pot and a bunch of books.
So were you a high school musical queen? Or
I wasn't the queen by any stretch of the imagination. I was in the chorus and the background.
Uh-huh.
It took me a while to move up to the front.
So, but you just always had that drive? You always had that interest?
I always was so interested in theater from a really young age.
Did you go to theater? Was there an opportunity to go to theater in Dallas? Or?
Not in Dallas, but even when I was living in, I lived in Dallas till I was about seven, and even at that age, I was sort of taking children's books and organizing them as a play and putting my cousins and my brothers, and we'd stand behind like the curtains in the living room, and I mean, it was sort of instinctual.
Mm.
I don't know.
It was just your nature.
Yeah.
And so was New York scary?
No, it was the best. I mean, I grew up in New Jersey after I left Dallas, and as soon as I knew what New York City was, I wanted to go there. So I was just kind of chomping at the bit, waiting to graduate college.
Because you've actually had a fairly remarkable run. I mean, 12 years of working is not something everybody always gets to do.
Yeah, and I got my first like professional job less than a month after moving to New York City. I waitressed for like 3 weeks and that was it.
So did everybody, all your friends hate you at that point? Or?
My friends hadn't even got to New York by the time I had, I mean, it was still the summer after college. You know, I got I got the first job July, the summer after college. So most of my friends hadn't even moved to New York yet. They were still back. I went to college in Ohio, so they were still in Ohio doing whatever summer job they were doing. So, and then I was gone and I was off doing the movie. And I mean, it was wild, wild, wild time.
And was that what you expected, was making movies?
No, because I studied theater. Mm-hmm. And although I had done some student short films in college, I hadn't taken any film acting classes or any film classes at all. So I didn't know how a day on a film set works, or moving from a wide shot to a tight and save it for the close-up, and all that stuff didn't really mean anything. Like, we're gonna shoot this as a cowboy and all this kind of language I wasn't familiar with at all, especially working out of sequence, because when you know, work for theater, you rehearse in sequence and then you perform it in sequence. So to do it out of sequence was mind-boggling.
So did you take a while to figure it out, or did it come
there? The guys that I did my first movie with, there was this actor on the movie, Dash Myhawk, do you know him?
Right.
And he's a really generous, smart New York actor. And I was just really lucky to work with him, because he sort of would just lean over to me in the scenes and be like, so what they're doing right now is an establishing shot, so you don't really have to do anything, just make sure you hit your marks. You know, like, he kind of talked me through Introduction to Film School while we did that movie.
And was it the whole ride of, when you got and did Coyote Ugly, was that a, I mean, it seemed like a giant thing at the moment.
It was.
Such a Bruckheimer moment.
Bruckheimer is so giant. I mean, the way that he puts out a film, you know, the publicity and advertising, the opening of a Bruckheimer movie is something that he is so good at and does in such a big way. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have any, I had this one indie movie come out, and then my next two movies were studio films, and they were both coming out like within 4 weeks of each other that summer of 2000. And he didn't have any friends in the movie business or know anybody, so I didn't know what to expect, or I didn't even know how to dress to go to the, you know, I was really, it was a real blind turn.
Yeah, it's like we were talking to Carey Mulligan at Sundance, I guess two Sundances ago, when she was in an education there, and also in a movie called The Greatest, and the thing she was still hadn't figured out how to be in front of a still camera. And it still freaked her out to do the still, you know, everybody wanted to do beauty shots and whatever.
Right.
And she was like, nah, I don't know.
No.
And of course now she's on the cover of Elle and...
and looks perfect.
Yes, she knows exactly how to do it now.
Yeah, practice makes perfect.
So does it spin your head, or do you, does that seem like part of the same work when that all starts happening?
That is totally different work from acting work. I think publicizing a film, for me it's... it took a lot more time to learn how to do, because you have to be yourself.
Mm-hmm. Well, you don't have to be.
Well, you don't have to be. And that's totally right. Actually, you can choose to make up a persona that you do for the press, and you can keep that, or then you can decide how you kind of deal with it is a whole nother thing. I think that there's also nobody to tell you about, you know, and how to feel. Do you read your reviews? Do you listen to what people say about you? Do you take it seriously? Do you implement it into your work? Do you ignore it? I mean, how, and there's no books on that or anything. You know, how would you know unless you're friends with somebody?
So, did you read your reviews? Did you pay attention
to
your reviews?
I don't read the reviews.
From the beginning?
From the beginning. I think if you read them and you let the good ones lift you up, you're sort of opening the floodgates to let the bad ones knock you down. And I think that you don't always know what it is that's gonna kind of worm its way into your brain, but that one sentence or that one remark that just happened to hit in the right spot, and that can kind of cripple your work for years, maybe forever.
So was working with Rocky and Bullwinkle the same as working on every other movie set, or?
I mean,
obviously the work itself is different in some ways.
The work was different because it was the first studio movie I did. I'd only done one other movie, but what was awesome about it was the actors that were in it. I was the only kind of rookie, and it's, you know, Robert De Niro and Carl Reiner and Jeanine Garofalo and John Goodman. I mean, the list was so extensive of who was in it, and I would go to set even when I didn't shoot and just sit on set and watch people work. And so to see that breadth of different people and how they work and how they talk to a director and how fast they can get it, how they behave, what good behavior gets you, what bad behavior gets you. It was really an education.
So as you're going through all that, do you start to get an idea of what quote-unquote Piper Perabo is?
I think I got an indication of what I would like to be. Not that then you can do it, but like at least you have a target to aim for, you know, about how I want to try and work.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
What about career? Was that a consideration, or you just... fielding offers.
It's in some ways fielding offers, and also figuring out like what's really worth fighting for, and how do you read something, and what are you listening to instinct-wise about, you know, I think that's gonna work, or how do you know you can really kill it with something?
So is it character, or is it the director? What is it that draws you to a project?
And has it
changed?
It's different things. I mean, with a script, it'll be like if I kind of have an emotional reaction while I'm reading it, then I know it's kind of ringing true for me in my life at this moment. But then I have done whole projects just because X person is in them, or X person is going to be the DP, and I love their work so much that I think, I'll figure it out. I just want to, you know, be in a scene with them.
And has that worked out? Have you enjoyed those?
Sometimes it does, and sometimes it doesn't, because you don't really know. You know, be careful when you meet your idols, you know. Sometimes it's good, and sometimes it's a nightmare.
Yes.
I'm sure you have that experience.
I've had that experience.
Like, you sit down with people and you're like, oh my God, you're crazy.
I have a friend who's been trying to hire a DP over the last 6 months, and it's like, she keeps on meeting these guys who are, you know, her idols, and oh my God, and it's like, I can't work with that person. They're trying to take my clothes off.
Right.
And make me drink a lot.
Whereas other ones, you think they're going to be these wild dogs, and actually they are really grounded, really focused, really serious. You don't really know until you meet somebody if you can.
So is there a point where you started feeling settled in, like you kind of were You had landed and now you were, there was another step, or does it still feel like the same journey?
No, there was a certain point where I felt like I had settled in and it wasn't happy with it, where I landed. And so I went back to class. I like stopped working altogether. Mm-hmm. And I went around New York to the actors who I liked, even asked to be introduced to some that I didn't know, whose work I liked, and started asking them where they trained and who were their coaches and who were their teachers and blah, blah. And then I picked a Meisner studio and went and did the 2-year program. Hmm.
And how was that?
It was scary at first because I thought that the people in the class would be like, what are you doing here? You know, you're already working. And but it was the opposite. They were really supportive. And all of a sudden I had all these people to work on my auditions with and like break down scenes with. And it's helpful to prepare for auditions with people who really want to help you prepare, you know? So it changed everything, really.
So is it like going in with having your craft established and kind of knowing the craft of it and then having to work on the art? Is that the...
What I did was I had a craft and a way of working established, and it wasn't serving me well enough. I worked with Christian Bale in this movie, The Prestige, and I saw him work, and it was working with him that I thought, how are you doing this? Like the kind of arsenal of emotional, physical weaponry that he has to create things is so extensive. And not only that, but he can, if he makes a change or the director suggests a pretty radical change in a moment, in a scene, he can adjust so completely that it's more complete than someone who has been working on that moment for months preparing for it. And I just thought, like, there's gotta be more to know, because what you're doing is like gymnastic level of work. So I threw out my whole way of working when I found this new teacher and began like from the beginning.
So is that the kind of work you want to do? Because I mean, in some ways, I don't know if this is what you didn't like about where you were, but you know, pretty, blonde, perky, you know, that's
yeah, what and you get a little, I was feeling a little really trapped in there. And Christian has this incredible ability, I'm sure you've seen The Fighter, but I can't even recognize him. Even when he bursts out laughing, or the whole face mask is different. And I was like, how the fuck are you doing that? I love it.
So is that where you'd like to go? I mean, do you want to do end up doing a
I mean, I don't know
Charlie's
if I can
Throne turn and put on 40 pounds?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, the fact that he can be Batman and then be this guy in The Fighter, and it's the same actor within a few years of each other, to me, that's really interesting and challenging, and I'm curious about trying to do that.
So is going back and taking the time to do theater after even you've done the training part of that journey?
And the director and the writer who were doing the play that I did do this kind of, Neil LaBute and Terry Kinney. And Terry, you know, started Steppenwolf and is one of those really full-on radical actors. And so I thought, yeah, these are the guys to start trying this out with.
It feels almost like the opposite, that the two of them like are a complete mismatch. Like,
they
are.
The
most misogynistic writer ever and the most sweet guy.
The kindest guy. But it makes for a good kind of frisson when you're trying to get a story that's raw, because you don't get, you know, Neil has a tendency to get, it's dark, and Terry has such a tendency to, he is a sweet man, but he has a propensity for emotional rawness in both positive and the negative. So the combination, I think, gets you somewhere interesting.
So was that experience a great, great experience?
Was it awesome? It was totally awesome. It was great.
Like reconnecting with your roots, or?
Well, mostly just working with people that were that good and having that kind of time to rehearse a play, put it up, and then we went dark, and then we put it up again on Broadway. So we had a long time to really work it out, and I could try all this new training with these people that I had the time. They were smart, they want to put in the time, you know?
And then you end up in an hour long.
But I'm sure I wouldn't have been able to do what I'm doing in Covert Affairs if I hadn't really gone through all that.
Because
first of all, doing television is, I think doing hour-long drama is the hardest job in the acting kind of deck.
Particularly when you're in 80% of the shots.
It's insane. I mean, the days are so long and you're moving so fast and the writers are having to write so fast and so you have to be more facile, I think. And somehow have something to keep giving, because it's not, it's like a machine. Like the machine starts eating faster than, or the machines don't eat, but you know what I mean.
So is that a whole different learning curve for you? I mean, is it something?
Yeah, I mean, thank God I had Chris Gorham. Because Chris Gorham has done so much television, and he's really smart and talented and a calm, normal person. Mm-hmm. And so he could, when I was like, what are we doing? I can't believe there's 10 new pages for tomorrow. And he'd be like, it's okay. This happens all the time. Let's read them, you know.
And is it, has it become fun?
It was, even though it was like, oh my God, it was still fun the whole time. Mm-hmm. I mean, the two creators, this is their first show that they've got on, mm-hmm. and they're both like these sweet, smart men.
Right.
And I love their ideas. Mm-hmm. And then Doug Liman knows how to make this incredible action. So the combination mm-hmm. is kind of, you know, the kind of wild ride that I think is really fun to do.
Is the physicality, have you really done anything that's this demanding physically?
Nothing.
Because you're running and jumping and falling and...
Yeah, like jumping down elevator shafts and like, I mean, it's like I've never done anything this... Especially when like I have to do it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? They'll be like, we have 15 minutes before lunch. Do you think you can jump from that boat to that boat? And I'm like, yeah, if I miss, it's a total hair makeup redo. You guys know that, right? They're like, yeah, you're not going to miss, right? I'm like, no, let's try and get it forward. Let's go.
And that's part of the challenge, I guess.
That's what makes it exciting.
And do you have to keep it fresh? I mean, you're going to go to a second season, it looks like, certainly.
Yeah.
So, I mean, do you go in going, okay, I need to figure out another arc, or that I need to bring something else to the character and make it more fun, or keep it going?
I know that, like, for the second season, there's a lot of things that I think I can do better, and relationships that I can kind of dig into in a more interesting way, and so I'm excited to sort of get the chance to do that. But I trust the writers to do the arc, and just committing to it more and like risking more in the acting.
And how do you fill your time between the activities? Do you look for something challenging in a different way, or?
You mean between seasons or between?
I mean, I guess you've already been off of this show for 6 months or something.
Yeah, well, I was injured in the finale.
Ah.
Sorry,
I didn't get the memo,
much.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. So I had some time rehabbing from that, and then it's like just going after the injury, then just like getting back up to speed of like kickboxing and you know,
what
Krav
kind of
Maga. I broke my leg in a fight scene.
Wow.
Yeah.
Just kicked too hard?
No, somebody fell on me.
Ow.
I know.
So do you then fake the rest of the episode, or did you, where's the last scene? And
we stopped.
And does the episode die, that particular
episode? No, we only had like a day and a half to go. Uh-huh. And so we used like stunt doubles and when we came back and did some close-ups and...
Not you behind a, you know, bench or...
Yeah.
Like they do with pregnant actresses.
Exactly.
All the time.
It's like being pregnant, but you don't get anything at the end of it.
You're pregnant
with
your leg.
Back to nothing, right?
That's always, I think with actors, I always find in certain movies or TV shows or whatever, when somebody shows up with a cast, I'm always like, okay, so is that somebody being really wacky and coming up with this crazy idea of the guy's working with one arm?
Right.
Or did he actually break his arm in the first day?
I would think you better have really broken your arm, because you're going to have to commit to that cast for at least a few episodes.
Yeah.
It's going to get annoying.
In a hurry.
Yeah.
Not as bad as bondage gear, but you know.
But
once you get down the elevator shaft, everything's okay.
Exactly.
That's a theory I'm working on. I think that bondage gear probably is the Golden Globe nominee right there.
You think?
I think so.
Maybe I should have sent all the Hollywood Foreign Press bondage gear.
I think you would probably guarantee a win with that.
Shoot. I still have a few days.
Next year. Next year's nomination.
Right on Sunset. There's got to be a store.
That's right. There are plenty of stores. But believe me, they're all there, too. You may run into the Golden Globes as you go. And the language thing in this, so it's kind of like every episode's a new language.
We're up to like 12 languages at this point.
Literally, you know, six, but you'd have 12. Actually, I think my wife was trying to count them as we were watching episodes of the season. And she's like, did she actually, wait a minute, that's too many.
Well, sometimes I was like, you guys, honestly, really? I speak this one too? Yeah, I have, because this is sort of funny. Toronto is the most ethnically diverse city in North America. Mm-hmm. And so I have a native language speaker for all my different languages. Mm. So I can you know, like when I'm speaking whatever, my Portuguese, my Portuguese guy comes to that and we just like run it.
And does it come to you easily? Is that something that's...
Most of them do. Sinhalese is a little difficult for me.
Not that we would know as an audience, but when they sell a show to someone...
All the Sri Lankan people, when they're watching, they're going to be like, our Sinhalese is terrible.
But that's, again, kind of the goofy fun of...
Totally. When you're trying to like speak German and shoot somebody and like jump off a bridge, it's fun.
Is it always, do you get tired of jumping off of bridges at some point or go?
Not yet.
I need a day off of jumping off of bridges. I need to. You're kind of like mellowing out, feeling better.
Mellowing out, feeling better. Actually, I'm revving back up. I've started training for season two already.
So then you'll go into that in the next couple months?
Mid-March.
And then will you look for a Broadway show? Will you look for a
indie? Or? It would be, actually, I was talking with an actor friend of mine about doing a play together when we finish season two. Actually, I talked to two people about doing plays. I hope they don't talk to each other. You got to have a couple irons in the fire. You got to have a couple leading men in the fire.
So you're still
hot in time.
It's still an actor thing. You're still you're still looking for your next job.
Oh yeah.
At some level.
Totally. And also looking for it actively as opposed to like waiting for the next job. You know what I mean? Like, what are you doing in September? Do you want to do this? You know, kind of like I'm hustling.
Well, slotting in TV shows and stuff does make it very challenging.
It does.
You kind of need to know your schedule and need to.
And, you know, it's hard to balance everybody's schedule is always a challenge.
And is there a specific kind of thing you'd want to look for? I mean, would you look for something more indie, more tough, more raw? Or is that just the material that turns up?
It's sort of the material that turns up. I mean, it doesn't have to be, it'd be interesting if it was something I hadn't done before, like a character that was new to me. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't have to be more anything, it just has to be good. You don't have to have like kind of a emotional response when I read it.
And does Piper Perabo the Enterprise stick in your head at all at this point, or are you just...
Sure. I mean, I try to...
You're not a real tabloid girl.
I try not to be. I try real hard to stay out of all that.
Just stay out of the quiet rooms instead of the loud rooms?
Yeah, I mean, I think you can't... I think at the level where I'm at, you can stay under the radar if you don't go to the wrong places with the wrong people, or the right place. If you don't go to the right place with the right people, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. And the indie stuff, you now don't have really much time for, I guess. But you really did find some challenging roles in there along the way that
some of the most
a lot of people didn't
stuff.
Get to see.
Yeah, yeah. And some of that was, I mean, I really like going to the film festivals. Mm-hmm. Like when I did Lost in Delirious, that was because I had seen Léa Poul's film in Portemois at the New York Festival. Mm-hmm. And so then I went looking for her. So I think like going to the festivals as an actor is still really useful too, because you're kind of looking for who's speaking to you.
Do you feel like you have that's a movie is kind of like in a different track than the rest of your career? I mean, it's like you have a different audience for that
definitely.
Film.
Definitely. Definitely.
Lesbians and teenage boys who are...
With swords.
zooming through it in DVD.
Totally. But I mean, it was a really important... It really spoke to me, the script. And then when I met the director, it was like, let's figure this out. You know, she was so smart and sensitive.
Well, it's almost like the trouble that movie had in distribution had a little to do with your profile... The size of your profile, it felt like people wanted to see you be
do that again.
That girl,
definitely.
And this movie was heavy emotional movie for your character in particular. Everybody was emotional, but your character, I think, really bore the brunt of it.
Well, all the jobs that I was getting offered when Coyote came out was like doing another Coyote, and I was like, well, you guys, I just ate that. Like, is there something else on the menu? Or so it helped me even. I mean, I even more wanted to do Lost in Delirious because it was so different.
And have you gotten used to all this stuff, doing the press, and is it, because you seem very comfortable, you seem very open and relaxed. And
thanks. I'm trying to be more open and relaxed.
Were you less open and relaxed before?
I think, yeah, I mean, I guess I just didn't always trust that I could be open and relaxed.
Mm-hmm. Well, you can't always be open to relax.
That's true. You can't.
I mean,
and so
watch your back.
You know, you mess up a couple of times or you say the wrong thing and you're like, oh gosh, that's going to be everywhere. You know, so it's a mix of being conscious about what you're saying, but also trying to be yourself.
And do you look back much? Do you look back at your movies? Do you watch yourself, or you?
No. Oh God. No. God, no.
So you're uncomfortable watching yourself.
I always, well, after it's finished, I always see the piece and like look at it pretty critically about what's working and what's not. But if I'm going to watch things, I'll go watch somebody else work.
Do you watch dailies?
Oh, I shouldn't say this. I only watch dailies if I don't trust the director.
So, in a show like this, though, you don't really even have a chance to watch dailies.
Oh, you'd be surprised.
The tapes still come in.
Well, you can go and if I feel like it's not clicking and the conversation is not happening, I'll go and watch the take right away, so that I can kind of better interpret what the director and I are trying to say to each other. Like, if I can see what he or she just saw, and they have some kind of issue, it's easier if we're both, you know, measuring with the same tape or whatever.
So you're looking at the daily, when you look at the daily.
I don't look at dailies, I really look at playback.
And you're looking at how you're managing the work on set, not so much at your performance.
If I look at playback, I'm looking at, is this shot functioning as it needs to for the story right in this one beat, and am I helping that or am I in the way of that? And then adjusting and trying to listen to what the director's saying to see how he or she's trying to adjust it.
We had an actor who did one of these, and she was setting up and she asked to see the frame. And she thought she was being very anal, and she said, you know, even on the movies, I like to know what my frame is. Because somehow that's where you work within that, and that's your proscenium, I guess.
I mean, I think the more you know about lenses, the more you start to know your frame. Like, I was watching Breakfast at Tiffany's not long ago, and there's a shot where Audrey Hepburn's looking for her other shoe, you know, when she goes under the bed, but she puts her hat on before she goes under the bed to get the shoe. And so that when she looks up from over the bed, it's a frame within a frame. And I thought, oh, you fucking know what lens they're using. Because she knows, she's framing her, like she's doing it herself. You wouldn't put your hat on before you look for your shoe unless you really know what lens the DP is using. And so that's so smart.
Is there a point at which you became conscious of that kind of thing?
Yeah, but I mean, I don't know where it was.
Was it 15 films in? Was it?
There must have been. Maybe it just comes bit by bit. Or when you finally see the movie and you're like, oh, that's what he was trying to tell me.
But don't do that, because your neck's going to be.
Right. Yeah. Oh. I wonder if I can. I guess we can't fix it now.
Because it is remarkable how certain actors really do know their light and do know exactly what the angles are and can work that.
And some actors, like, if you tell them, it flusters them like a racehorse, and they're just like, I can't think about that. I can't think of, you know
probably
what I mean?
Kristen Bell on some level. But I mean, for you on this show particularly, I mean, every shot is a beauty shot with you. I mean, they're trying to get an angle. They're trying, you know, every outfit is very precise and very fitted. No matter what you're doing, there's a see-through blouse and a, you know, the right bra and, you know.
Well, I owe that a lot to my cinematographer. Jamie is, you know, really good and fast and smart, and we know each other really well. So when he'll be like, I'm gonna light this with a China bowl, so I need, and I'm like, oh, I know. You know, we're like right there.
Well, the costumer's with you too, though.
I mean, that's true, but in the final moment.
We didn't know the CIA
moment,
dressed quite this way. From the Louboutins to the blouses, including the boss too. The woman boss is like,
oh, yeah.
She's wearing a cocktail dress to
and
work
Jimmy
the
Choo's.
CIA. And Jimmy Choo's. And was that a touch that you guys, I guess you started from the beginning because that was in the pilot.
Yeah, yeah. I wanted to wear, in the pilot, because I go back for my shoes in the pilot, and in the pilot, it wasn't Boutins, it was something else. And I was like, you know, you really wouldn't go back for those shoes. And the writers was like, what would you go back for? And I was like, me? I go back for a lot of Boutins. And if you pick that shoe with the red sole, girls who like shoes, you know, having watched Sex and the City for years, girls who like shoes, they know what you're talking about, and then you see that soul and you know what it is. And I was like, it's a mark and a thing. And they were like, you know, they're just two cool guys, but they don't know about shoes for girls. And they were like, okay, great, like cross it out.
So is it in your contract now that you have a new pair of Louboutins for every episode?
It's not in the contract, but I can tell you there's a lot of those shoes on the costume truck.
Like Bill Shatner is known for having a contract that gives him a new hairpiece for every episode.
Oh, that's not
famously
true.
Famously for T.J. Hooker, yes.
That's really?
He had a hairpiece for every episode. And so he has like, you know, hundreds of hairpieces by now.
How difficult to transport that must be. Or maybe you can just throw them all in a bag, I don't know.
It's all like, you know, first there was Liberace, now there's Bill Shatner. And the careers go on and on and on and on. So do you want to do you imagine yourself being Bill Shatner someday? So you not compare you to Cher and Bill Shatner?
I know.
But I mean, 20 years from now, 30 years from now, do you look out that far? Do you think, okay, I want to be Betty White when I'm 80?
I mean, God, that would be cool, actually. I mean, I'd rather be like, I mean, when I'm older, I'd rather be like, you know, Judi Dench or Elaine Stritch or, you know, even Angela Lansbury has done some really fun stuff on Broadway recently.
Still working, amazing.
I know, right? It's amazing.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
When
it's
you're,
awesome.
You know you're really in a unique place when you have to replace Betty, you know, Angela Lansbury with Elaine Stritch, because there's nobody else that age.
Right.
Who's still working that anybody knows.
The list is real short.
Really tiny list. So will you design your career to take you to that place? Will you think that
way? I mean, I don't know if you, I mean, people say you can design your career. I don't think you can. I mean, I was at this party once, and this guy, and he walked up to Leonardo DiCaprio, and it was the year that he'd done Departed, and he was like, you made some good choices this year, man. You made some good choices. And I'm like, I can't make some good choices. Like, some great films happened this year, and he's a genius, and he did them. But it's like, those were the things that, you know, it's like, I don't know. I think, I mean, I don't know. I don't know his life and how he makes his choices, but I think, in a way, it's partly just the zeitgeist, and you do the best work that you can, and and you try and do the best you can with it, and hopefully it comes out well. I don't know how much you can really design it.
You just choose to live, I guess.
Yeah, you just try and do your best.
And figure out what you're about, and you actually care about that.
I do.
You're not just trying to work. No, I mean, it's a dilemma, I think, that actors come about, where they, you know, there are some very good actors who do all kinds of things because they have to put food on the table. It's
That's
not like
true.
It's a, you know, sometimes it's a calling and sometimes it's a job.
And sometimes the same, both are happening within the same career. You know what I mean? You do one because it's the calling and one because it's the job, so that you can pay for the house and, you know, feed yourself.
And you feed yourself emotionally.
Exactly.